Good evening, Kiran ma'am. I'm Rachna Prashant.
Hey, Rachna.
Hi, ma'am. How are you doing, ma'am?
I'm doing very well. I see so many beautiful young faces, also bright and brilliant faces. I wish I could have seen you personally and hugged you.
Ma'am, there's some echo from your end.
There's an echo. Where's the echo from? There's echo from my side.
Yeah, there's some echo.
Is it still there, Rachna? Yes, it is.
Yeah, it is.
Yes, it is. How come? We'll try and see. Checking 1, 2, 3, Rachna.
It's such a pleasure to see you and meet you, ma'am. Thanks to this online world. The world has become online.
Absolutely. But thank God for this technology, otherwise we would have all been lost. Mm-hmm. We would have forgotten each other's faces.
Absolutely, ma'am. Yeah, so should we start?
Yes, go ahead, Rachna.
Yeah, so I have to end at 5 o'clock, ma'am, sharp at 5. Or we can extend for 5-10 minutes.
We're already 5:15. We finish at 6:15. We have 1 hour.
Sorry, 6:15.
We have
6:15. Yeah.
We spend with each other 1 hour.
All right. Absolutely. So, with your permission, I would like to start.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone, and good evening, Kiran ma'am. Welcome to our Millennium Ma'am's Forum. Before we begin, ma'am, I would like to introduce you to our two founder mentors, Mr. Vishnu Dhaluka and Mr. Sanjay Bhuvania. Sir, would you like to say hi?
Namaste, Kiranji.
Sanjay Bhuvania, sir.
Namaste, Kiranji.
Kahan hai?
Niche,
meri photo paper. Ah, ye hai, theek hai. Thank you. Very nice meeting you, sir. Thank you.
So, they have empowered us through financial literacy, and they founded this unique organization 28 years ago, and they have touched the lives of more than 5,000 women in these 28 years ago, in the journey of 28 years. And you know, ma'am, when this lockdown happened, we had two options, either self-pity or to upgrade ourselves. I think you would agree with it. And we chose the second option. We are having our weekly classes, time lessons, positivity with Mr. Dhaluka, book review sessions, yoga lessons, and regular events. And in this way, we are honing our skills and keeping ourselves mentally and physically agile. Social distancing could not stop us from knowledge enhancing. And now, I'd like to take the privilege of introducing our guest of honor. Yes. Although she is a role model for all of us and needs no introduction.
She's not a role model, she's a rule model. Rule.
Rule model, wow. Fabulous. Fabulous. I'll just mute one or two people who are not on the mute.
Because I follow rules, I follow certain laws of nature. That's called rule model.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, my dear friends, is it possible to be an IPS officer, a college lecturer, a tennis champion, founder of two organizations for betterment of drug addicts and women, have a movie made about her life, an author, a reality anchor show, and a politician? Well, is it possible? Yes, it is. When you are Kiran Bedi, the first lady IPS officer of India. She is a leader, a game changer, and a brave heart with nerves of steel. She dispersed a political demonstration with just a cane, for which she was awarded the President's Police Medal. She spared no one as DCP traffic in 1982, towing a car that belonged to the Prime Minister's office. She was nicknamed Queen Beti for this. She is a reformer who introduced yoga and vipassana for Tihar jail inmates. She believes in the 90-10 principle, where 10% of your life depends on what happens to you, and 90% of life is decided by how you react. She has never compromised on her ethics and reacted to situations, keeping her principles in mind. She is currently the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, and we will get a glimpse into her glorious career today with her anecdotes. She is a woman who has taken her own decisions and has always been self-reliant. She is the best symbol of Atmanirbharta. Let us all give her a huge round of applause and welcome her to our forum. Ma'am,
so cute.
You have been a perfect example of self-reliance. So today, I would like to request you to please address us on the topic of self-reliance and how important it is for us as women.
Sorry to interrupt.
Ma'am, over to you. Over
can
to
we
you
lock the screen? Madam. Can we lock the room, please?
Now you can lock the room.
Yeah, I lock it. Yeah.
Because then all these new additions, talks will stop. See, I told you, yeah. I'm role model. Can you hear me clearly? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, lovely.
Yes, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Okay. Okay, Rachna, I know I've admired whatever you sent me in writing. I've read this carefully. And I fully respect and admire what you did. You all got together to reinvent. Rather than go underground, you came overground properly for reinvention. So that speaks volumes about you people, you as a team, and you as an organization. That's very good. Let me accept. Please accept my congratulations for that. Now what we'll do is, we will speak for about 10 minutes on what I think is self-reliance. How did self-reliance come into my life? I'll show you, share with you a little personal story of when did self-reliance come to me? What did it mean to me? You'll all have to switch off your, mute your mics, because otherwise disturbance will keep coming. So please mute your mics. And then after 10 minutes or 10 to 12 minutes, we will start taking Q&A more. Let's connect with you, because you are all bright faces. You need to, let's share with each other what you think. In fact, I'm curious to hear you.
Absolutely, ma'am. We'll take up the questions after your address.
Okay. Now, I'll tell you where what self-reliance meant to me. And what it means, because you can read a lot of theories about it. You can read Mr. Emerson's lecture on reliance, which is actually a treatise by itself hundreds of years ago. I remember how self-reliance hit me. I think it was growing in the field, growing from home. When we girls were growing up, we girls were told by our parents that you're growing up to stand on your own feet. Those days, I'm a product of the 50s, you see, because I'm 49 born, I'm a product of the 50s, and I went to the college in 64. So going back to those days, it was totally boys' world. It was those days, my time was not a girl's world. But the parents clearly sent a message that you will grow up to earn your own living, and that to lead your own life, and that you're not going to be dependent. You will be self-reliant. The word of self-reliance entered my ears when I was a girl. So when does self-reliance begin? I think that's my first message. Self-reliance can begin at any stage. Realization of self-reliance can begin at any stage. For some, it begins late. Some begins early. It all matter of that. But for some, they know about it. But they can't do it because of certain circumstances, because every home is not the same. Every school is not the same. Every teacher is not the same. Every parents are not the same. So it varies from home to home, girl to girl, child to child, person to person. Even men, boys were not self-reliant. Because I remember when I was again growing up, my father was an employee of his own father. He was not self-reliant. He was on a pocket money allowance of his own father. And he used to get a pocket allowance. His club bill of tennis was being paid by my grandfather, etc. So he had a pocket allowance. Till we girls started to come up in the family. And now the expenses went up. But my grandfather refused to increase the pocket allowance of my father, saying the children can go to a nearby free school. So why should you why should you need more money? See, he was dependent. So it's not only we talking about girls, we talking about human beings. Even men are dependent sometimes on their own family circumstances, as my father was. And sometimes there are many, even today, when the father is the karta of the whole family, then the son or the daughter continues to look up. Right or wrong, I do not know. It depends on varying. So I can't generalize everybody's life. I can only give you my example. Girls and boys both can be non-dependent. So when I grew up, I saw this dependence. I saw it. And I saw what it meant. So as a girl, sensitization, self-reliance, person are sensitive because they have self-respect. So first, another factor is the more self-esteem you start developing from an early age, you start moving towards what can I do for myself? Who can I rely on? What kind of decision making can I take? How can I become more confident? How can I increase my own ability? How can I increase my resources? Because reliance, self-reliance is linked upon what kind of support systems you're relying on, what kind of relationships you're dealing with, right? And what kind of financial dependence, because, and what kind of self-reliance on energy. I think the first thing you are self-reliant is when you have energy. If you're not having any fitness, you're not physically fit, you will be dependent on others all the time. You can do a limit. If you want to do extra, then you need extra energy, a good amount of energy. So my first criterion of self-reliance is good health, energy generation, and then comes ability. So energy to ability. So once you have energy, then how does ability increase? Ability increase by you knowing yourself. You know what you want. You know what you want to do. You also know why you want to do, right? Where can you get it? So you generate resources, whether it's finances or human resource, or create an environment, or you change your college, right? I'll tell you what happened in my school time, how it became another story of self-reliance. I was in the ninth standard in Sacred Heart School, Amritsar. And I was offered not the subject of my choice. I was offered, I was not good in mathematics. And I was given science with Hindi, science with no mathematics. They said, you take household. They used the word household that time. And I was totally anathema to household. I didn't want to be getting into household. I was running away from household. And here my sister was giving me household. And when I looked at the book of household, it talked about budget making. It talked about spices so much, vegetables so much, plana so much. And I said, oh God, I'm not growing up to keep a budget for the house. I thought I'll outsource this. So, and I, can you believe, ninth standard, I told my mother, Mama, I cannot remain in the same school. It's one of the best school in the city of Amritsar. And I said, I was already a woman who knew what I can, what I will do, and what I won't do. What I won't do is household. What I will do is a lot of work outside. Though household is a great thing, my mommy was household. I'm a product of my mother's household. I admire her for that. But I didn't want to be like my mother. I wanted to be, and nor did my mother want me to be like her. My mom wanted me to be what she wanted to be as she was growing up, but she got married early and got dependent on my father. I didn't want to be having a dependent relationship. So my friend is number one, start early. My first message is start early, but doesn't matter. You can never, never miss the bus. You can move towards self-reliance at any age. But I must say, the younger you are, the better, because then you are more energetic. You have more resources and also environment to grow and reinvent and invent. Now, in COVID times, I think we are becoming self-reliant now. because there is a physical distancing. There may not be social distancing, because if we hadn't been social distancing, we wouldn't have been together like this. But it's physical distancing. Now, in physical distancing, it's back to energy. If you have good health, you are, otherwise you do not know who to depend on. So that basically means giving time to yourself. So as you grow up, you are moving on ability. You must also grow in your mental and physical health and spiritual health. That's a lot of self-reliance. Because if you are spiritually sound, mentally strong, physically energetic, and knowing what you want to do, then you will create your own resources for self-reliance. This is what my story. So from the age of 12, I knew that nobody can dictate to me what I want. I will dictate, because that's good for me. It's good for me. That's my course of way. So this is, so I would say self, it's ability. What is self-reliance is ability to do things and make decisions for yourself. It's a key word. Ability to, this is I think coming from Emerson's lecture on self-reliance. He says it's ability to do things and make decisions for yourself. Now, whether you're 12-year-old, which is the kind of decision I took, or you go on taking decisions. So by your own efforts and abilities, that's what he says. Ability on to depend on yourself to do and get things done and meet your own needs. This is coming straight away from Emerson's lecture. He's most famous for and worldwide. So I would repeat, it's ability to depend on yourself, do and get things done and meet your own needs, which means it takes you towards a lot of individualism. It takes you towards personal responsibility. It also takes you towards non-conforming. And the most important of all, as Emerson said, is trust yourself. That time at the age of 12, I was trusting myself. I was trusting my instinct. What is it that I don't want? What is it I want? It's a trust within. It was not taking social approvals. It was not in doubt. I was clear and trusting myself. It didn't matter how young I was. That's a beginning of your self-reliance. Now, whether I was born with it, whether I was trained with it, I think you are not born with it. Let me tell you, you grow in it. You are nurtured in it. You're born with certain tendencies, yes, but they can be suppressed. The certain tendencies can be held back. But in my case, I was nurtured both by my father and my mother to groom the girls to be self-reliant one day. And the whole theme of the house was self-reliance. That's why both the NGOs, which you mentioned, one is the India Vision Foundation, which educates prisoners' children and works with released prisoners and programs inside the prison. Second was the Navjyoti India Foundation, which works with the education of the urban poor and the rural poor and the rural in the rural areas. So it is the, you know that I set it up 34 years ago, and the tagline of my foundation is self-reliance. Prime Minister is talking about Atmanirbhar. Do you know what he means? He means list out all that countries dependent on others. Because COVID revealed that the time of crisis, we did not have PPE commitments, we did not have masks, we did not have personal protection equipment, we didn't have ventilators, we didn't have this equipment to immediately. And during the lockdown period, what did India do? Indian machinery, India, those people who could manufacture, they immediately crafted ventilators, they made PPEs, they made masks. They made all these equipment which is essential, because even the PPEs and ventilators were being imported from other countries. A lot of our markets are totally flush with foreign stuff. I don't want to mention any country right now, but it won't be politically correct. But why should we? That's what the Prime Minister said, Atmanirbhar, which means every Swadeshi movement, when we were fighting the Indian freedom movement, that self-provide pride. Gandhiji, when he said boycott foreign stuff, Swadeshi movement, when we all burnt foreign clothing and we all became khadi, it was self-reliance. It was bringing pride back in your Indian roots and being Indian. So I think the message is that there are certain times compelling circumstances. Today, India is being compelled to become self-reliant. And in a short time, they are manufacturing their own ventilators. They're manufacturing their own personal protection equipment. They are now also manufacturing a lot of masks. So in this kind of equipment, we are no more, and the test kits, even the testing kits. In shortest time, because of the mother is invention, necessity is the mother of invention, that we have gone to become moved towards self-reliance. I think what every India and Indian needs to do is go global, from local to global. And he's right, be vocal about the local and then global. I think it's an opportunity. We can tap talent around, reinvent ourselves, and see what can we do, create, whether we can do virtually or otherwise, to move towards self-reliance in our entrepreneurship. Now, I cannot imagine self-reliance without financial self-reliance, along with energy, particularly for a woman, because she chooses to financially make herself independent, because she has a choice not to be, because she can, if she has a trusting friendship, a trusting family, and she thinks she's needed much more at home, it's her choice, and it's a very good, very reliable, credible choice. It's a very respecting choice. But self-reliance in finance for some is critical for their self-respect. For me, finance was my critical, that I, after, from my graduation time, I started by telling my parents, I'm going to study on a scholarship because I'm topping my master, I'm topping my political science, I'm a national tennis champion, so why can't I get a scholarship? And I went and challenged Punjab University Vice Chancellor to say, you want me to play for you? Then scholarship is the answer, otherwise I'm going elsewhere. And he said, no, you cannot go anywhere, you play for Punjab University. So my question here is, then you start asserting, because you got the confidence in self-reliance. So self-reliance is nurtured. It can slip out also. It can slip out of your hands by certain few bad decisions or relationships. It can. But if you go back, continue to be an energy builder within, I think it helps you bounce back. Decisions can come your way where you can make certain decisions. But right or wrong, that only later on one realizes. But it is very important to stay alert. And in self-reliance, alertness, to my mind, is the key. It's called not only trusting yourself, because if you take bad decisions, as I said, unless we overtake ourselves, others will overtake us. So I was very careful that if somebody is not overtaking me, whether it's personally or professionally, overtaking not in the sense of beating others, is to say, am I passing on decision making to others? So I think this alertness is very critical. That's what I said. Then let me speak for about 10 minutes. And I close with one more story before we start taking question answers. When I came here as Lieutenant Governor Puducherry, and I was appointed here, do you know the first person I called for a meeting was my law secretary? I asked the law secretary, as a Lieutenant Governor, I've heard a lot of stories about what Lieutenant Governors are and governors are. Who am I under the law? I first want to read, you tell me, what are my powers? Legal powers, what are my constraints and what are my parameters? And the law secretary explained to me, madam, these are your financial powers. And it told me, you have final financial powers. As an administrator, you are the final approver of finance. You are the custodian of finances in Puducherry as Lieutenant Governor. I was quite surprised. I hadn't heard that. Then he said, madam, on service matters, in Group A and B, you are the final appointing authority. Others may have any views they can write on the file, but when it comes to administrator, you can take a different view as well as final administrator. So service matters, you have the final powers. Financially, you have the final powers. And on other policy matters, policy, new policy issue, you are the final person. The files have to come to you. And you have to approve a change of policy. Whether it's water policy, education policy, any policy, you will have to approve it. And third, fourth thing he told me, that if you have a difference of opinion between an elected government and the left and you, then you can refer under the law to Government of India to take the final decision, because you're an administrator and you're a union territory. Why I'm saying, I wanted to know exactly my power so that I can rely on rule and law. Not in every word is my power. मैं क्या करूँ यहाँ? कुछ नहीं करूँ. मुझे पता है. ये मेरी power है. ये मेरा रूल है, ये मेरा कानून है, मैं इसको यूज करूंगी। अगर किसी को पसंद नहीं है तो तुम्हारी प्रॉब्लम, मेरी नहीं, बट मैं समझदारी से यूज करूंगी। सो सेल्फ रिलायंस एज पर द लॉ। नाउ व्हाट इज द मैसेज इन दिस इज एज वुमेन एज एंटरप्रेन्योर्स एज बिजनेस मैन एक्सेट्रा वी मस्ट नो व्हाट इज माय सोर्स ऑफ लॉ पावर फाइनेंसेस स्टैंडिंग ऑर्डर्स what are the new policies. That means we need to stay very up to date with government changes. Today, every day, there's a new policy coming, a new announcement coming, and the banks coming up with their own operating procedures. We have websites. We must do our own research very carefully so that we know when we approach a bank, when we approach a district collector, when we approach a district administrative authority, we should know the rule exists. So when you say, I need this, and if he says, I may do it, I may not do it, sorry, this is the rule. I'm quoting this rule, unless it's changed. So I'm applying under this rule in law. Please apply, please do this. Here's my application. He'll understand that he's dealing with a smart, self-reliant woman, an educated woman, person who's sure of herself and confident, and he won't take you for a ride. So I would say it's very, very important that we do these. We make ourselves rich. Well, anyway, I've said enough. Let's go to Q&A now and see whether my other ideas will come through your Q&A. Go ahead, Rachna.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, thank you so much for the wonderful address. I would say firing address. And with your permission, I would like to request Neha, my colleague. She will be taking up the questions.
Okay, great. Go ahead, Neha.
A very good evening, ma'am. It's my humble pleasure and privilege to welcome you here.
Thank you, Neha.
Ma'am, you've taken many adverse situations and actually changed them into something which has become a milestone event in your life. And Tihar Jail is one of the finest examples. You introduced several reforms with a zero budget. Ma'am, what are the challenges that you faced and how did you do what you did?
Neha, I hinted at that whichever work I went to, whichever work we do, it's a thoroughness which helps. I was thorough in my rules. I was thorough in the law. I was thorough in my procedure. And I was correct in my intent. There was an intentional alignment with the purpose of my work. So if you mentioned Tihar Jail, the purpose of my prison was not to beat up the people, not to hurt them more so that they go back and take more revenge. Purpose of my job was that we treat them humanely, make them realize that they made a mistake and that they hurt people outside, but they're normal, they can be normal human beings provided I teach them humanity. So how do I teach humanity? I have no resources. So a self-reliant person, what does he do? He or she raises resources. We raise resources, appealing to schools outside, appealing to NGOs, appealing to many other philanthropists to donate used clothing, used books, pencil, copy books, books that publishers didn't want to use and sell because of certain damage. All that was secondhand. I invited a lot of secondhand material to be given to 10,000 prisoners every single day with no money, no pension. I raised, so in a way it was in cashing your goodwill, but I could do it because I saw the rule was, I was as Inspector General, the policy maker. Had I not seen that rule, I would not have done this. I will give you an example. There was a rule, the jail manual was, one of the rule was that prisoners cannot be allowed wristwatches, pencils, books, copy books and transistors. It said the rule. Because one day I was walking inside the prison and I had forgotten to wear my wristwatch. And while walking, I asked my person, hey, what's the time like? Why, kya time kya? Bolo, madam, I mean, hum ghadi nahi pehnte. Main kya, kyun ghadi nahi pehnte? Hame allowed nahi hai. Maine kaha, achha, ek aadmi ko ghadi bhi nahi allowed hai, to kaisa jeevan pitaita hota hoga? Kitni anyay ki baat. I felt, this is, isme security risk kya hai, ghadi pehna, isme kya hai? So when I came back, I held a meeting and I said, why don't we allow wristwatches, उनको कैदियों को, अरे घड़ी पहनने में क्या प्रॉब्लम है, उसको पता होना चाहिए 12 बज गए 1 बजे मैंने उठना है सोना है, मतलब मैडम ये अलाउड नहीं है, क्योंकि द रूल वॉज एंड ऑफिसर रेड द रूल लाइक दिस. नाउ लिसन टू दिस केयरफुली, इट सेड द फॉलोइंग थिंग्स आर प्रोहिबिटेड, ट्रांसिस्टर्स, बुक्स, रिस्ट वॉचेस, पेंसिल्स एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा, एंड द वर्ड नेक्स्ट वर्ड वॉज लाइन वॉज अनलेस प्रोहिबिटेड. It said, following are prohibited unless permitted. So I told the colleagues, I said, pura sentence padho na. Pura sentence kehta hai, unless permitted. So unless permitted kyun nahi hai? Bole, madam, unless permitted kachari dega. I said, kyun? Ye toh aapki power hai, superintendent ki power hai. Aap dijiye, aapko kya problem hai? Aane koi problem, madam, aap allow kar do. So imagine, jo cheez permissible bhi thi, wo nahi dene di. तो मैंने क्या किया, मैंने सिर्फ रूल को पूरा पढ़ा, वो बाकी ऑफिसर्स सेलेक्टिवली रूल पढ़ते थे, मैंने सिर्फ पूरा पढ़ा, फर्क ये था. एंड आई अलाउड रिस्ट वॉचेस, बुक्स एटसेट्रा, ट्रांसिस्टर्स, सो दैट दे कैन लिसन टू द न्यूज, दे कैन लिसन टू म्यूजिक, दे कैन रिलैक्स देमसेल्फ. इट वॉज ह्यूमनाइजिंग देम. सो व्हाट डिड आई स्पेंड? आई स्पेंड नथिंग. आई ओनली रेड द रूल प्रॉपरली एंड अप्लाइड इट ह्यूमनली. You need to mute. Rachna, you need, some people need to mute.
Yeah. There's some background noise.
Yeah. Please mute yourself, all of you. Please mute yourself.
That's better. Now the sound is gone. Okay,
Neha. Yes, sir. Ma'am, there's a question from Sonali. She's asking, a person has to go through a lot of criticism and opinions when she does something radical.
Any suggestion from your experiences how to cope with the criticism? Look, you will, if you get praise, it's fine. If you get criticism, so what? But what you've done is right, what is ethically and morally right, and the need of the hour, and that you're capable of doing it. Change is always difficult, but if you convince that it's required and you have the capability of seeing it through, will you, if you accept praise, accept criticism as well? And look at the feedback of the criticism. What is in it? If it is just jealousy, ignore it. If it has value, use it. So in a way, it's a feedback for you. Don't look at criticism as criticism. Look at it as a feedback. Pick and choose out of it.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, another question by Srila Mitra. Ma'am, your thoughts on the police being a protective force and the recent cases of brutality both in India and globally? What, in your opinion, is the way forward?
Whose brutality?
Recent cases of brutality both in India and globally.
Look, these are not for the first time. These brutalities you have had, has, you've had worse brutality in the past. If you watch some documentaries of World War One, World War II and many others, and during the British times, you had worse brutality. You cannot wish away brutality, because there will be individuals who will be remaining brutal. You had a recent case of a policeman using his knee to suffocate a person. Am I right? This is not the first time it's happened. But the point is, it's an individual mistake. It's not a systemic mistake. So never treat it as systemic. I think these are individuals, and you will always have individuals making such like blunders. But only thing is, whatever protection one can give to oneself, one must do. But don't get depressed by that brutality. Learn lessons out of it and move on.
Yes.
Ma'am, the next question from Rama, Bangalore. Of all the myriad things you've done in your life, which has had the most social impact, and what did you enjoy the most?
From whatever what?
From all the myriad things you have done in your life, which has had the most social impact, ma'am. Which has the most social impact, and what did you enjoy the most?
It's very interesting. You know, life, memory is short, but I do know that anywhere where I put my heart and soul and gave everything to it made the difference. Whether it was traffic police, whether it's prison management, whether it's district police, whether it's my NGO work, whether it's the governor's office now, wherever you put your heart and soul in it, you transform things. You change things for the better. So how can you really compare? Because situationally they are different. But do you know what? Every decision that you take as a leader, it makes the changes in the lives of people you don't even get back to. But they've grown up and they remember. You remain a memory in their mind. But I'm telling you, every day has a great value. Isn't the one which we are having today of great value? Isn't the interaction which we are having a great value? How can you undermine this at the moment to say, oh, my yesterday's webinar was better than this? Everything stands out for its own value. Only thing you have right now is put your heart and soul in it. Before I came to you, I read for a number of hours what self-reliance is. I did my homework for you. I prepared myself and collected my own thoughts to see what is the best I can give you in the shortest possible time. So you put your heart and soul as a conscientious citizen. That's the key, is putting your heart and soul in it. And you don't have to be told. In life, you need to be self-driven all the time. You have to generate your own energy to do this, a willingness to do this, because you want it. But if you don't want it, then don't do it. But if you want it, then give it all to make the difference.
Wow. Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's the fire within that takes you places.
Yeah. Neha, we can bring in few people to ask questions. I think Yutika wants to ask. Yutika can come forward and ask.
Sure. Yutika, please ask your question.
Can I start? Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Rachna, for giving me this chance. Good evening, ma'am. And it's absolutely an honor to be seeing you right across the sea today, because you have been a big role model in my life.
Role model.
Ma'am, I would just like to share.
Role model, yeah.
Before the question, I would just like to share something, ma'am, that the town that I come from, Belgaum, over there, these salons had a haircut called Kiran Bedi haircut.
Are wa?
Because when girls used to go there to get a haircut, used to say the Kiran Bedi haircut, and that's when we used to get it. And we followed it during our NCC days.
Wow.
Because tying that figure of eight was difficult. Ma'am, I have a question. Being the first woman IPS officer, you are the example of shattering glass ceilings. Can you please share some of your experiences, the significant ones that you've shattered, and how did you overcome those obstacles?
Look,
Ma'am, especially the one where you gave the parking ticket to the Prime Minister of India.
Yes.
You know what? I think we set our own limitations. I'm answering in a manner by which it remains not a personal answer, but a conceptual answer. So I'm trying to answer every question of yours so that you can pick up an idea here or two from me. So it doesn't remain my own personal story. But it only becomes an example because it's the past, as you can use it as an example. I think what was important here is that we set our own limitations. We set up our own boundaries. I did not set my own boundaries. I did not set my limitations. I did not feel low or less than anybody else. Because when I'm getting the best education and I'm getting the best opportunities to do, why should I limit myself? My limitation is only one thing. It has only 24 hours of the day in which everybody is equal. Yutika, you don't have more than 24 hours and I don't have. I think the only limitation you and I have is a boundary of 24 hours. But the real challenge is, the difference between anybody A or B or C is, how do you use your 24 hours? I think I stretched my 24 hours and made them into, it's like 3 days work in one day, because I gave it all. I loved doing it. Because I loved doing it, I dedicated myself fully into it. It didn't bother to me, mujhe kisi ne kaha ya nahi, mujhe iska inaam milega ki nahi, koi recognize karega ki nahi. Mujhe pehle apne aap ko tasalli karni hai ki maine is kaam ko tan man dhan diya, apna tan man diya. To usse kya hua? Everything got shattered. The more doors opened, you see, and the jurisdiction kept getting wider. And then everybody, you see, when you talked of my haircut, it was actually making myself boundless. I was unshackling myself. Ki main apna time idhar kyun bataun? Let me make myself free of this. so that I don't have to maintain anything. I just can have a shower 3 times a day and I can dry through the sun. So the point is, this is the point. Why did I go for a haircut? It was nothing else but to actually break myself free of such things which were excess for me. At that time, playing tennis, this was surplus. So I said, let it go. So what I'm saying here is that you set your own dimensions. If you keep stretching your own, even in the LG's work, we have stretched it. How? By reading the rule rightly, by going out and working with people. Just before I worked with you, I had a webinar with my Manrega women who are in the villages. So they were all connected. They're all doing rural work. And I was having a webinar there with them. I don't understand Tamil, but I was there for them to clap for them to say, I know you're doing a good job. So they feel madam is seeing us. You see, that's a stretch. There are no instructions to the LG's office from the Prime Minister's office to do webinars. What? How do we stay connected? So we are stretching our own space. So the moment you start stretching your own and create your own space, what do? You serve more. And in the end, you feel a fulfilled day in the end. So I think we design our own dimensions of self-fulfillment.
Can we have Namita come in with a question?
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, I'm somewhere on the screen. There are lots of us. Ma'am, I wanted to ask you is, what have you learned from your innings as a politician that you haven't learned in your long career in the IPS?
Namita, what did you say? What have I learned from where?
Can you be from your innings as a politician that you haven't learned in your long career in IPS?
What have I learned?
What did you learn as a politician?
What I didn't learn in IPS?
Yeah.
I learned that I learned that there's no better job than the IPS.
What have you learned in your innings as a politician?
That I learned that I can never be a politician. And I should not go off track. That I will never make a politician and the IPS remains the best service. I'm basically a service-oriented person. I do not know politics. That was by chance that I got into it. It was situational. It was to meet a particular challenge. But I will never do it again. I realized it.
Okay.
Yeah,
next. It's a huge honor. My question to you is, your job requires huge amount of spiritual quotient. It's not easy. Where do you get from day after day?
By daily nutrition. You cannot, whatever you read till yesterday is settled. You need something fresh again. So if you, just as good health remains only by daily good food, similarly, my spiritual quotient remains daily nutrition by a daily fresh reading, fresh listening, fresh inspiration. So I inspire myself, read something nice. I search for something good to hear every day. It's a daily habit.
Anything in particular, ma'am?
Yes, I read the Speaking Tree of Times of India daily. I read the spiritual column of Economic Times daily. I listen to Sadhguru's speeches daily. I listen to Sri Sri Ravi Shankar as often as I can. So I read inspiration daily. So I go to even other inspirational talks on the computer, on my laptop daily. I look and search for nutrition. So what happens is that what you read till yesterday gets reinforced and you add something new. So it remains current. But for me, it's hunger. I am hungry to listen. I'm hungry to learn. You have to be a learner every day because what you read yesterday is settled. You need to add. It's like eating good food every day. You cannot have a holiday on good food. I cannot have a holiday on spiritual nutrition every day. And this spirituality is not how it makes you read spiritual books, religious books. No, it's not religious book reading. It's about how do you become better human being, where you understand your human emotions better, you understand conscientiousness better, you learn yoga more. I think it's all about awareness.
Wow. Yeah, Dr. Kaveri, she wants to ask a question, Neha. Dr. Kaveri is writing.
Sure, please come in. Dr. Kaveri, would you please go ahead?
Yeah. Yes, please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Kiran ma'am, Jai Hind, first of all.
Jai Hind.
And just to tell you that we have been talking over the mail. Email पर बात हुई है. This is Dr. Kaveri Purandar from Ahmedabad.
अच्छा
जी मैम, सबसे पहले तो ये जानना चाहूंगी कि डॉक्टर किरण बेदी के डिक्शनरी में डर नाम का शब्द है. Do you have this word in your dictionary?
मैं बिल्कुल साधारण ह्यूमन बीइंग हूँ, मेरे में भी डर बहुत है, और क्योंकि मैं डरती हूँ इसलिए गलती नहीं करने की कोशिश करती. मैं एक चीज डरती हूँ कि जो मैंने अब गलत किया मुझे शायद कभी भुगतना पड़ेगा, इसलिए मैं गलत ना करूं. I do believe there's a karmic bank. I do believe there's a karmic bank. And ever since I've become very aware of my karmic bank, I don't want to do anything which is intentionally wrong. So I do believe, so I am afraid. I'm very careful. Let's say when you are afraid, you become careful. There's a positive way. So I'm positive. I'm very careful that I don't want to do anything, hurt anybody wrongly or do anything intentionally. So if it's not intentional, if it's good. So it's not karma. I want to build good karma. I don't want to do something wrong with intentionally. So there is a karmic bank, I do believe. So I'm afraid to do anything intentionally wrong. So I remain very careful. I remain very alert. But not all the time like madharere. Nani, it's a habit now.
Yeah. Neha, over to you. Next question. And then we...
Sure. Let your thoughts come and go. But don't certainty. This is one of the lessons taught to you by your Vipassana teacher, ma'am.
Correct.
How did Vipassana bring about change in your life?
I think I can divide my life into two portions. One was which was before Vipassana and one which is after Vipassana. Vipassana heightens your self-awareness in a big way because it teaches you 10 days of total silence and teaches you self-observation in a big way. And that is the time when you really realize every thought has an impact on the body and how the body reacts to it. And if you want that thought to be maintained, that you have to self-observe. And then you also realize the fleeting moment, the how it doesn't stay, it just goes. There's called anicca in Vipassana. Everything's impermanent. So there's a law of nature which you start seeing for yourself how impermanent everything is. So what are you hanging? Therefore, your needs come down. By Vipassana, your needs come down. There is no greed in you then. There is only a need. And even the need comes down. So you become very realistic. You become very practical. Vipassana makes you very down to earth, but also makes you very conscious of your responsibility. So it makes you, your duty, spirit heightened, but also makes you very grounded. So you're neither very happy, nor are you very sad, because you are more equanimous. You realize even this will go and that will go. However, it's a daily practice, and the more one practices, the better one evolves towards that. So Vipassana makes you a self-observer. It detaches you from yourself and it makes you see yourself, which means it makes you a two-in-one.
That is beautiful.
Very well said. Self-observer.
Half the battle is won, man. One achieve that. Ma'am, thank you for all the lessons you have taught us with your life and your word. Thank you. Here we all thank you with a grateful heart, ma'am.
Thank you, Neha.
Over to you, Rachna.
Ma'am, I would take a few minutes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, since we are on the topic of self-reliance, and I would like to introduce you to a movement by Millennium Maps, which also focuses on self-reliance, but on the national level. Vocal for local, as we all know, It's a strategy to revive India, initiated by our Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji. And we all are very much aware that India is reeling under the dual impact of COVID-19 and economic slowdown. And there is a lot we can do to stimulate demand so that India is able to get back on track. Be Indian, buy Indian. And ma'am, on this momentous occasion, we would like to take the pleasure of launching this initiative, Vocal for Local, to support Indian companies and MSMEs and to get economy back on track. Ma'am, if you could say a few words and encourage our members to be Indian and buy Indian, and in that way, we would like to launch this initiative of ours.
Identify all the products which you buy, all the products which you people we all buy. Let's look at if there is a good, equally good Indian substitute. Take that, choose that, promote that, so then market it. And that's called vocal. Become vocal of the local product. And number two, there are many organic stuff which is being Ayurveda and organic etc. products, clothing. I think there are a lot. Or create yourself. So wherever you're buying, going to the market, and if you have a choice to make, prefer that. Prefer khadi, prefer the something which has been made of jute or something Indian or a craft. If you can make a choice rather than buying an imported stuff, buy the Indian stuff. Automatically the market will go. It's like, remember on the when Smriti Irani was textile, and on the textile day she said everybody wear one cotton shirt. So many billions of millions of shirts were bought cotton. So one day it gave a big boost to the khadi movement. So I think these kinds of movements we can build. The cotton toilets, the cotton, the Indian stuff which is woven, because some things are just going by the jute. Many original things are coming on the net. And then you can share the product. The Patanjali products, I do not know, they could be great. Art of Living products are brilliant. Sri Sri Ravi Sri, and by the way, they're all available online. Sadhguru's products are also, Isha Foundation products are also online. I'm using Art of Living products. I use the eye care, I use the drops for the water. They're brilliant. Some of them are very nice. So I think using such products, and they are all available online, order them online, and that will be great support for the foundations which are doing such a great cause. So I think all of you can research as a group. You research one product which we can substitute and order online. You see the kind of local and vocal you will be. Each one of your member identifies one product which is a better substitute, where you can buy rather than buy the imported, you buy made in India and order that online. The Chyawanprashas, all these are very great doctors. Ayurveda, homeopathy medicines, they're all Indian. So why not? So you find a product and then circulate it amongst yourself.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. And we are already spreading a lot of awareness on all our social media platforms. And we wish that we will be able to achieve this and make India self-reliant. And this is the brainchild of our mentor, Mr. Dhanuka. I would request him to come in and, you know, say a few words on this before we launch. Dhanuka, sir.
Namaste, Kiran ji.
Namaste, ji.
Namaste, Kiran ji. बहुत अच्छा लगा आपका जो स्पिरिचुअल डायमेंशन बहुत ही जोरदार लगा मेरे को बहुत बढ़िया
थैंक यू धनुका साहब थैंक यू सो मच
थैंक यू
धनुका साहब
एंड देयर इज अ मेंबर प्रतीक्षा गुप्ता शी वांट्स टू आस्क अ क्वेश्चन आई सपोज
यस
प्रतीक्षा
हेलो एवरीवन
यस अलाउ मी टू शेयर माय लाइफ चेंजिंग एक्सपीरियंस विद I've been a survivor because of, oh my God. Yes, Rachna, share if you wish.
Ma'am, this is Pratiksha.
Pratiksha.
Yeah, Pratiksha.
Oh, sorry, Pratiksha. It's Pratiksha. Okay.
Yeah. How are you, ma'am? How are you doing?
I'm doing well. It's all Almighty's grace.
Ma'am, actually, in 1998, my father passed away. And the only time, very attractive.
Neha, can you read it out, Neha? We can't hear.
I can't find a question, Rachna.
Pratiksha, speak.
actually the thing that happened is in 1999, other
fans. There's a lot of echo we got here.
Yeah. Can you please type your question?
Yeah, if you could type your question, we can read it out.
You type your question. She wants to say something.
Yeah, there's a lot of echo we got here.
Something actually, it's not a question.
She wanted to share something.
Oh, okay.
Can you?
Let's all mute Rachna. Let's try to mute and then see.
Let's mute.
We are all on mute.
We all mute. Even I can mute. Even I'm muting. You go ahead, Pratiksha.
Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am, now? Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yes, actually, ma'am, the experience is in 1998, my father passed away and I was the only child born after 8 years of their marriage. So I was very attached to my father. And after his passing away, I was into acute depression. And I was trying to commit suicide. But the same day, I read about Vipassana, which were held in Tihar Jail. And I was very curious to know what is Vipassana. And I read multiple of your interviews and multiple of your write-ups. And then I went to Igatpuri for Vipassana. And in the guidance of Mr. Satyanarayan Goenka, I went for first 10-day session. And I was so inspired. Then I again Dantinta kiya, so far I went for 21 days. And after that, my life changed. And today, I'm a sadhvi, I'm a sannyasi of Dhuna Akhara. And I'm practicing Vipassana and I'm inspiring people to make yoga, meditation, and a yogic lifestyle a part of their lifestyle. And not to let depression and shortcomings make people commit suicide. Ma'am, I'm really, really, really thankful to you. And if you're noticing my haircut, you're my ideal, you're my role model. I have this haircut because of you. I've been connected with you on Instagram and today you have replied to my story. I'm so grateful to you, ma'am. Thank you so much. And please, I would like to meet you in person someday. And this is my only wish in life. I want to meet you someday, ma'am.
Thank you
so much, Vipassana.
Wonderful, Pratiksha.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Super. Wow. Let's all give her a clap. All of us give her a clap. Super. See, she found her own answer. And today she's a self-reliant woman. Here's an example of self-reliance. She searched for it. And see, nature, destiny, put her through. So, Pratiksha, all courses karte jao. And become a teacher also. Vipassana ki teacher bhi ban sakte ho.
Ma'am, by profession, I'm a medical dental specialist. I've done journalism. I've been an MBA. But everything was certain. But now I'm a sannyasi leading a totally spiritual life and making people aware of our spiritual aspects also and importance of spiritualism. I'm not talking about religion. I'm talking about spiritualism in a person's life. I'm working on that. And ma'am, I would really like to come and join for your NGO also, work for your NGO also, ma'am. I'm really inspired.
By which city are you in?
Ma'am, I'm from Nagpur. Nagpur.
कोई बात नहीं आपको कहीं और नहीं जाना नागपुर को आपकी जरूरत है आप नागपुर में सेवा करो ओके ओवर टू यू रचना
यस एनी मोर क्वेश्चन नेहा एनीवन वांट्स टू आस्क यू कैन कम इन We have 8 minutes more.
Yes, please come in for with your question.
You can unmute now. Yeah.
Hello.
I think Alka wants to ask.
Yes.
Anamrita Suwani.
Yeah.
Yeah, please come in.
Good evening. With a beautiful happy to you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, I wanted to ask. So there's like you said, that people will shun you. It's about your confidence and how you take it. So ma'am, what was your support when you started your journey? Like you said, your parents had taught you to be self-reliant. What was your biggest support and how do we women make support systems around us. Having kids, having family, there's a lot that they need help with. So what was your support system and how did you manage them?
Mine was my family. Mine was 100% my family. That was where my, and in the family were my most important support was my mother and my father. They were my family. Sisters are obviously the family, but my mother and my father were my pillars. And mother even more than my father. So because it's because of my mother that I work 24/7. She wanted me to continue working. It's because of her I did further studies. So she was a very big motivator. See how wonderful mothers can be wherever you have. और अगर माँ नहीं मिले ऐसी तो फिर क्या करो फिर अपने आप को माँ बनाना पड़ेगा अपना खुद डायरेक्शन लेना पड़ेगा सो अगर माँ है ऐसी तो दैट मीन्स आपके ऊपर भगवान की बड़ी मेहर है बिकॉज मदर इज अ गॉड्स गिफ्ट बट इफ यू डोंट हैव एनी फैमिली सपोर्ट लाइक दिस देन यू हैव टू बिकम सेल्फ सपोर्टिंग योर सेल्फ by constant preparation, nutrition, friends, then your friends, you may come across some wonderful friends. And when you have associations like these, networks like these, this is your family. You should now make them your family. This is your support system. Right? Okay, Namrata?
Sir has given us a very big support system.
Good. I'm so glad.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
And you have said, life,
so
you either go up or you go down.
Yeah, Neha, you've done a lot of research.
And you're such an inspiration. I just went in and in, reading all that you've written, and I was enjoying myself completely.
Thank you so much.
But ma'am, that's one of the things you learned from your parents, right?
Yes, that's right. Oh, it was my father's quotation. Oh, there were two quotations which have been with me. My father said, life is on an incline. Either you go up or yes. You come down. So therefore, my daily nutrition is my life on an incline. I read, so I keep going up better and better. Thinking, clarifying, understanding life. Okay? And my mother said, you are not to take, you will only give. So kabhi maa ne kaha tha, aise haath nahi phailana, aise karna. So these are my two things which have stayed with me. Mummy said, always give, don't take. So remain a giver. And Papa said, life is on incline. I think it makes life complete. But then you have to live it every day. Okay?
Can we answer that?
Yeah, one last question. Huh?
Yes,
ma'am, I just wanted, upon this book, Black Warren, and the author writes a lot about you and the changes you brought and how he was inspired by you in Bihar jail. But what really shook me was that these hardened criminals have such a human side to them. And what do you think drives a man to commit the kind of crimes they did?
I think sometimes we are vulnerable to circumstances of life. Bad company, circumstances sometimes take you towards, and you are vulnerable. So circumstances and vulnerability, compulsions, temptations take you towards that side. But then when they got an environment to change, they accepted it. Human life basically is lovable and peaceful. No child is grows with violence, crime. No child. Violence grown comes later. Crime habits come later. It's the environment which gets is impacted. But every human being is born with a certain amount of morality and ethics. It's the environment which changes them. So it's not the nature, it's the nurturance.
The society plays a big role in it.
Immediate environment, not society, immediate environment. Your friends, your family around. Friends and family.
Okay.
That is why friends and family are the most influential at the growing up stage. School, friends, family, and your education, your teachers. Your teachers, your parents, and your friends. These are your immediate influences. However, there's a percentage which also gets impacted by the media, where they learn stories from the media. That's impacting equally, right? So there is a percentage even of that. That's a fact. That some of them have learned the crime from a movie. They learned the crime from a program. And then they invented it. So there is also that percentage. But again, it's an environment. Now, this is the society, social environment where the media is in. He is absorbing the media in a negative way.
Kiran ma'am, when I last met you, it was at a prize giving ceremony at Lamartine School, Kolkata, if you remember.
Oh, really?
Yes, wow. Last time. I think it's been 7 to 8 years now.
Lovely.
And this time you're sounding more energetic.
Puducherry. Puducherry is a clean.
Kolkata, Lamartine.
Puducherry is a very clean and a neat place. Puducherry is a very nice, clean, neat, and it's a spiritual place. And the ashram, Sri Aurobindo ashram, is right behind us. See, there's a lot of vibrations coming here.
Fantastic, ma'am. And with your permission, I would like to wrap up the session. I will take any.
And let's all do an e hug. Rachna, let's go on all an e hug. E hug. E hug.
Yes, all of us. Let's do that. This was so beautiful. It was really like, you know, today's session will be etched in the memories forever. And we really got food for thought, and we really need to introspect so much. Thank you so much, and you are our real role model, I would say. And we wish you all the success and in your current role and in your future endeavors. So much for being there today. Session to end, we want to listen more from you, but yeah, without taking any more time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.